He's not only a commissioner of the Securities and Exchange Commission, he's also a recognized name in the world of fintech.
In fact, Commissioner Kelvin Lesterly received the highest prize in the Asia Pacific Stevie's Award for his contributions in fintech. He was also recognized as a fintech regulatory and innovation leader by the Asian Fintech Academy. Commissioner Lee now joins us live in the studio. Good evening, sir.
Hi, good evening, ma'am. Thank you for having me. Okay, sir, thank you for having
me. Glad your name is Kelvin Lesterly. It's a lot easier to pronounce than the company.
Than a certain company?
Okay. I'm not touching that one.
Right, sir. Let's talk about some of the things that we have in the news today. Mm-hmm. Issues on short selling. The PSE is excited to have it within the year by Q4.
Right.
And then some other issues on derivatives and more IPOs in the market. Maybe you're doing some things to. I know you've been busy doing roadshows to encourage SMEs even to list in the PSE.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we've had these roadshows. No, we've started earlier this year to have these roadshows on a monthly basis. Now our next roadshow, and I'd like to invite everyone to drop by. You know, it will be held at the SEC headquarters in Makati. You know, we've moved there recently, and it's on the ground floor of our e-center. That will cover NCR and Calabarzon. No, we're looking at roughly 400 to 500 participants for that particular one. So that we're actually very excited. Unfortunately, I won't be there. I have a previous engagement. I have a speech to give in London. No? But certainly that will be a very good event because this will be a chance for everyone to get together here in Metro Manila finally.
And on short selling.
That's coming. The PSE has been very cooperative with us, as well as the PDTC. We're working on the last portion of this, the accreditation process for as a lending agent, no, for the PDTC itself. So that's coming very, hopefully it's coming in the next few months. My understanding that the issues are being threshed out. I have to applaud the parties for being very cooperative with each other.
What are there any sticky issues there? That's why you're still finding.
There is a difference, I think, in opinion among the technical people, but the policy direction remains the same.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the policy direction remains that we want this to happen, and we want this to happen this year. So certainly, it will move forward one way or the other.
How do we make sure that nothing like the GameStop thing will happen?
No. The issues in relation to GameStop are not even remotely similar here. No, in relation to the factual setting.
Mm-hmm.
Don't forget that GameStop required a certain set of people, yung nagkumpul, they got together, and using the Robinhood app to get things done. No, I do not believe we have the same factual situation. We don't have an app similar to the Robinhood, nor do we have such a. What was that red group called? I think it was a Reddit group that I'm aware of that's working in that direction. Nor would there be stocks that I think that would be vulnerable to that, at least not to my knowledge. So I don't foresee that being an issue. Besides, the short selling that we're foreseeing is on a fairly limited basis. No, it's in a way, it's like a dry run as well for having full-blown short selling later on.
Okay. I was thinking if I was going to follow up on speaking about apps. Mentioned already the Robinhood app.
Yeah.
We don't have any app like that yet, maybe, in the country. But you did, GCash had its dry run for stock trading through the mobile app. And a few months back, you did mention that there were a couple of companies who were interested in doing the same thing. My question is the interest still there?
Yes.
And even after that, are there more? Are there other companies, aside from those who initially said that they were interested, who want to go through with that as well?
Yes. Let me clarify my answer earlier. No, in relation to there not being a similar Robinhood app, there are certain apps actually that are here already that have Robinhood-like features in the sense that they want it to be as simple as possible for users.
Mm-hmm.
So we have that, and I have to laud them for that. No. This is technically not considered an endorsement, no, but these are the ones that are just approved fairly recently. So there's Dragonfly, I forget the name of that other one right now, but I've seen the GCash system as well. No, that's working pretty well, the one working out with AB Capital.
Mm-hmm.
So my point in relation to there not being apps that are Robinhood, I meant in the sense of in terms of wide dissemination.
Right.
But in terms of some of the features that they've been rolling out, so in terms of some of the interest in that direction, it's there. No, it's there. And I have to, the fact that there have been so many of these apps that have been coming, I counted roughly two or three in the last couple of months, shows you that there is an indicator of how there's interest in going into stock trading here in the Philippines.
Through an app.
Through an app, no, online. And fairly quickly. I've seen the dry runs of these things. No? They've worked very well, very quickly.
No kicks.
Now, Not that I'm aware of.
So more coming into the market.
And yes, on
right
that point,
now we have the Gcash
with using the AB Capital module. There's the Dragonfly. There's one that works very well. Also, wait, let me just check my phone. I'm trying to remember
the
name.
To test it,
but I can't. I don't use it. No, I forget the name. I can't find it right now.
It's okay. We can check.
Right. But sorry. I'll get you.
Salve
the name
and I will take a look at that.
Yeah, How about global stock trading through apps?
That is something we're studying. Mm-hmm. Whether or not we will push through with that will be the subject of a very extensive policy discussion internally at the ICC. Certainly, it's something we're looking at because we benchmark against other countries. There are a number of other countries already doing this. I can name, for instance, South Korea, South Africa, the US, Japan. These are jurisdictions that are already doing and getting into stock trading, foreign stock trading already. So it is in that context that we're looking at and considering this also for the Philippines. Now, precisely because we don't want to get left behind after all.
Yeah. Okay, the SEC has also delayed the release of its framework for crypto assets, and this was triggered by the collapse of FTX. But in actuality, the SEC was ready to release its regulations, I think, if I'm not mistaken, even as early as last year, right?
So
what needs to be looked at again to possibly have an improved set of regulations?
Mm-hmm. Well, to touch on that point, I was actually the one who announced that we were pulling it back upon instructions of the NBank. I was supposed to announce that we were coming out with those rules for public dissemination. At the time, we were calling the DAO and DAX rules, the digital asset offering rules and digital asset exchange rules. Mm-hmm. It was during the Philippine Blockchain Week. I had a keynote there. So funnily enough, the keynote became a discussion on the new rules. It became a discussion on why I'm not releasing the new rules in the interim. But bottom line, it was because of the FTX thing that we were not quite comfortable coming out and disseminating those rules. So we're looking at trying to make it a little more, all-encompassing, trying to make sure that something like FTX will never happen here in the Philippines, because at the end of the day, it's about investor protection. Now, we have to make sure our investors here, the Filipino public, the consumers in the Philippines, are protected extensively.
And that may be a delicate balance of allowing new technologies to come in transacting, in handling money, but of course you still have to come in and protect the people and consumers and traders from getting burned. Is it difficult to make that type of one?
Yes. I bring that up fairly often in some of my keynotes. The delicate balance between having to balance between the needs of the public, the protecting the public, financial stability on this end and everything, and the fast pace of these innovations. Because admittedly, some of these innovations can change the game. They can bring some vaunted issuances to the public. But at the end of the day, you have to err on the side of caution. At least from the regulator's perspective.
Of course.
You have to make sure at the end of the day that the public is protected, that the financial stability of the economic system remains safe. So that's the context that we have to look at here, I think.
Well, look, it's Blockchain Week again.
Yes, it's coming up.
So, is there a new set of rules that will you be coming out with? Set of rules on the regulation of all of these apps? For example, a group a couple of weeks ago also asked, if are you ever going to regulate the use of Binance in the Philippines and other kinds of apps that allow people here to trade crypto and other assets?
Two aspects to that. One, I'd like to remind everyone that we have issued multiple advisories to the public, reminding everyone not to invest in entities that are not registered here in the Philippines. And the entities that some of the entities you mentioned, as far as I know, are not registered here in the Philippines. And secondly, it is precisely these rules that I mentioned earlier, the DAO and DAX. Although we're renaming the DAX rules to the Digital Asset Security Service Providers rules. Those rules will be the ones that, in theory, at least from the SEC's perspective, that will help us us in relation to regulating this particular space? We're looking at the at these digital assets, for instance, as investments, as securities, depending on how they're traded. Mm-hmm. But of course, these will depend on the factual circumstances of each particular case. Now, so we have to look at the nuances still. But mm-hmm. overall, as a principle, overall as a policy direction, that's where we're looking at, regulating this site, certainly regulating it and to help stabilize it.
That means they have to apply
for
a license mm-hmm. to operate in the Philippines before SEC says, okay, I don't have an advisory against you anymore.
That's one way of looking at it. I think you're contextualizing it in relation to the entity we're just talking about, no? But yes, in theory, that particular entity, if they want to come into the Philippines and operate legitimately, then of course they have to come to either us or the BSP later on. But I understand they have a lot of hurdles, no? Mm-hmm.
They have to have both. VASP.
That would be my position on it. Yes, right. No. That would be. I cannot speak for BSP. I cannot speak for the central bank. But certainly that would be my position. They're gonna need to come in, incorporate as a company here. I don't think they're incorporated currently. And of course, they have to come in and then get the appropriate license from us, and then later on from the BSP or vice versa.
The SEC has always had its hands full in going after and clamping down on erring companies, mm-hmm. most especially those unregistered ones. But you just have to go online. Mm-hmm. You just look at an app store and mm-hmm. you see a lot of companies preying on people. Yes. How is the SEC on policing doing, and how has the SEC coped in trying to take them down?
Well, I laud, for instance, some of these larger companies that I've been working with, some of the larger online companies, for instance, Facebook and Google, speak to me on a fairly regular basis. Mm-hmm. They've been very cooperative in the sense that if we go through a process with them and then we refer particular names or websites or apps to them, they will take them down. So on that point, that cooperation, that collaboration with them has been very, very helpful. Secondly, we have these advisories that we keep issuing. We try to remind the public. In fact, just today, we issued three different advisors against three different groups of entities that are operating in Facebook, and I think on the Google Play Store, no? I'd have to check my notes. No?
A lot of them have to do with what people call love.
Oh, that one, that's different. No,
the love scam.
The love scam, that's different. That might not necessarily be us. No. bottom line, this falls under SEC jurisdiction if it touches on what would be considered investments, no, or investment scams, that's the case maybe. So I guess what I'm trying to say, Sir Ron, no, is that we're active in this space. In just today's NBank, as I said, we issued three different advisories already against entities that are operating online.
Do you work with the platforms, Meta,
yes.
Google,
yes. Yes.
keep these things out
yes.
of the
yes.
Play Store?
Yes, yes. They have, as I said, they have been very cooperative with us. No, mm-hmm. In particular, Facebook just came to see me. Meta just came to see me a few days ago. In fact, mm-hmm. Precisely to talk on topics like this, on how to continue our collaboration in relation to that. Google regularly messages me. The people from Google regularly messages me in relation to taking down particular apps as well from their Google Play Store. In fact, it is because of that collaboration with Google, for instance, that they have this setup where before certain online lending apps, for instance, are able to get on the Google Play Store, they have to submit certain requirements to Google before they can get there, no? Mm-hmm. Which is not typical for Google. Google Play, as I understand, has a more open door policy that if you want to put an app there, it's very quick. But they made an exception, and I have to thank them for that. They made an exception for the Philippines. Before you can get an online lending app up there, you have to go through the whole process of showing them that they're registered with the SEC mm-hmm. and they have our secondary license, among other things.
How do you think effective is it when the SEC issues advisories, no matter how many? Mm-hmm. We do help you out when we get those advisories.
Yes,
we do mm-hmm. read them in our newscast.
I
think you have more, Salve. But how effective are they? I mean, and for those people who get victimized by these apps, these mobile apps, and those online websites, how often can they read and can they? Can those advisories reach them, actually?
Well, that's precisely why we've been working with these different online platforms. Okay. One platform we've been working with, you just mentioned a moment ago, GCash. You know,
yeah.
We've actually been working on capacity building and information dissemination through GCash as well, where they're able to mention certain advisories within the app, as I understand it, or at least point to us so that they can come see our website and then find out which one has a problem. But this goes back to the point, the basic point, that there's only so much we can do as well. So we want the general public to remember as well, before you invest your money, please check with the SEC. That's why we always say, check with SEC. Mm-hmm. Check with us, find out if it's a legitimate company before you put any money in it.
Right.
And secondly, if it's too good to be true, more than likely it is.
I think all the corporations have to go into educating their staff also, so that less people. And under 1 minute, I know you've been very busy with the ASEAN taxonomy on sustainable investing. Very quickly, what's the latest there?
With the ASEAN taxonomy, we're already on version 2. And it's being benchmarked against the other countries in ASEAN now. In the Philippine side, we have something called the Philippine Taxonomy that we're working on with the Financial Sector Forum. We're working with the World Bank in preparing a draft. I'm looking at I'm part of the group. I head the subgroup that works on it, the drafting. We're looking at having that out for public use and dissemination by Q1 2024.
Nice.
Okay. Mr. Calvin Lee
yes.
of the SEC. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.